so much, Stephen. Good morning, everybody. It's a great pleasure to be here. I have to say, for souls like myself who find themselves drawn into administration, some of the highlights of the day can be events like this, in which one can get away from all of that and actually engage, if only briefly, in some thought and discussion about the serious meaty issues of academic life. So it's a great pleasure to be here for that reason. To welcome all of you here to this second day of the workshop, and also that's an odd thing to do, to welcome people who are visiting back from other institutions and perhaps abroad to the university, even though we are not in the city of Hamilton at the moment, but we are in a very beautiful setting in which I'm sure the discussion will be excellent. I'm here today, as Stephen said, to introduce our keynote speaker, Dr. William Schabas. For those of you who are not aware of this, Dr. Schabas is a world-renowned scholar and author of more than 30 books and 200 journal articles to his name, and currently Professor of International Law at Middlesex University in London, also Chairman of the Irish Centre for Human Rights of the National University of Ireland in Galway. Dr. Schabas is also an honorary professor of the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences in Beijing, and an associate professor at Université de Québec à Montréal. His credentials are extraordinary. From 1991 to 2000, he was a professor of human rights law and criminal law at UCAM. From 2002 to 2004, he served as one of the international members of the Sierra Leone Truth and Reconciliation Commission. Dr. Schabas is also an officer of the Order of Canada, and was elected as a member of the Royal Irish Academy in 2007. A lifelong scholar, a devoted researcher, he has academic interests which include human rights law, international criminal law, transitional justice, capital punishment, among many other subjects. It's hard to imagine anyone better suited to usher in this second day of the Humanities Research Workshop. So without further delay, please join me in welcoming Dr. William Schabas.
Thank you very much for the introduction. I feel a bit of an interloper here because I'm not really a professional historian and I'm surrounded by them. I can't even claim, as Michael Ignatio did, that he's at least done the doctorate in history. I did do a master's degree in history, so I'm kind of an amateur in the field, and I've dabbled in history regularly during my career as an international lawyer. Some years ago, I studied the origins of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights in Canada. Reference was made in the lecture last night to John Humphrey's participation, and I looked a little more deeply into it and wanted to fathom a bit about why Canada abstained in a vote in the Third Committee of the General Assembly on the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and found some fascinating material in the archives here in Canada. When I moved to Ireland, I tried to do the same thing and did some very interesting research in the Irish archives about the history of Ireland's relationship with international human rights law. Did a couple of papers on that. One which was fascinating, Ireland wasn't there at the beginning of the United Nations. Ireland only was admitted to the UN in 1955. So Ireland missed out on the drafting of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, but tried to make up for it when the European Convention on Human Rights was being adopted in 1950. And we had at the time a very interesting foreign minister named Sean McBride. Sean McBride, who had been the chief of staff of the IRA, who had begun his professional life as a child soldier at the age of 14, coming to Ireland in 1917 with his mother, Maud Gonne, the unrequited love of William Butler Yeats. And McBride was part of the coalition, and so he joined he was in the cabinet when he was elected in 1949. And he took a shine immediately to the project of the Council of Europe and the drafting of the European Convention on Human Rights. McBride had to sell the idea to his colleagues. And in those times, the plan was that states would ratify the European Convention on Human Rights, but they would have to make a supplementary declaration to accept the jurisdiction of the European Court of Human Rights. That changed about a decade ago. So now if you ratify the convention, if you're a new member of the Council of Europe, you're automatically subject to the jurisdiction of the European Court. But it wasn't the case in 1950. And so he had to sell his cabinet colleagues, particularly the people in the Justice Department, on the significance on the importance not only of ratifying the convention, but also of making the declaration accepting the court. And Ireland was actually the first state in the Council of Europe to recognize the jurisdiction of the court. In order to win the argument, McBride, the people in the Justice Department said, well, this is going to be terrible if we accept the jurisdiction of the court. There are going to be all these complaints filed against Ireland. And McBride said, don't worry. He said, I can't imagine how that would happen, that anybody would file a complaint against Ireland. And we found all this. We found the letters in the archives. And of course, 10 years later, McBride's no longer in office, reinvents himself as a human rights lawyer, and guess who files the first complaint against Ireland at the European Court of Human Rights? None other than Sean McBride. I did a second project on Ireland's involvement with international human rights, looking at a famous case that continues to be cited, which is the Ireland versus United Kingdom case at the European Court of Human Rights, the big torture case, and it dealt with the treatment of detainees and prisoners in the British prisons in Northern Ireland, and it's a case that's really a seminal pronouncement on the legal interpretation not only of torture but also of inhuman and degrading treatment or punishment, and something that we return to again and again, and has been of particular interest. The British said in the 1970s that they learned their lesson, that it was wrong what they were doing, and they were never going to do it again, and they were going to burn the manual that set out all the torture techniques that they used in Northern Ireland. But they actually kept a copy of the manual, and they pulled it out in 2003 and used it again in Basra. So there's been a lot of reference recently to that case. My current project, I should mention, I just brought it to show off because this just came out earlier this week. My latest book, which is called Unimaginable Atrocities, it's a term that comes from the statute, the Rome Statute of the International Criminal Court in the preamble. And it's a series of essays, really, about different issues in international criminal law. And there's a chapter entitled History, International Justice and the Right to Truth, where I look at some of the roles of tribunals in international justice, starting with Nuremberg, in the establishment of the historical record of historical truth and some of the issues that are associated with that. I don't think it's out in Canada yet, but it'll be out in a few weeks. I have some brochures, and if you order it from Oxford in the UK, you can get a 20% discount, but I'm not sure how that's going to play out here in Canada. My current project, which I'm nearly finished, is a compilation of the drafting history, what we international lawyers call the travaux préparatoires, of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. It's not quite history. It's a little different. It's not archival research. These are documents that are part of the official record that states construct. And so they understand when these documents are being created, the records of meetings and the amendments that they file, that they will be used subsequently for the purposes of interpreting the document and also of analyzing their policies and their positions. So it resembles history. It's something we don't generally do in national legal systems, is look at the drafting documents. Parliamentary records were historically considered to be inadmissible in court for the purpose of interpreting legislation on the based on the premise that what politicians say in Parliament is not to be believed or trusted, and doesn't give you any indication of what they really mean. So it's not a useful indication of the legislative intent. But at the international level, it's different. And so we look to those documents, and I've assembled them. It's quite a massive collection, 1.25 million words, so it's going to be more than 2,000 pages. And there are annotations, and there's a long historical introduction that I worked on as well. So there's a bit of history there. When I first pitched it to the publishers a couple of years ago, Cambridge University Press, they, of course, as you all know, you send them out for reviews of proposal, and one of the reviewers came back and wasn't very enthusiastic about the idea. The reviewer said, you know, maybe the writer has exaggerated the importance of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. It's really not such an important document now, and this has been demonstrated by a new book by someone called Samuel Moyne. And, well, I'm the first to mention the name, although is there a paper that's been submitted that doesn't cite Samuel Moyne's book? Is there, maybe one or two, but this is the topic, and it's not mentioned in the document for the conference, the proposal, but it seems to be like, you know, Bankel's ghost. Finally, the publisher, I told them that this was actually not only a significant document historically, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, but a document that in recent times has a renewed vitality at the United Nations now. The big excitement in the Human Rights Council is this mechanism called the Universal Periodic Review, when all states are required to account for their human rights performance before their peers, before the Human Rights Council. And one of the things it's done is plug the gaps that we have in the human rights treaty regime, so that, for example, China, which has not ratified the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, and therefore has assumed no explicit obligations dealing with matters like capital punishment, comes before the Human Rights Council and talks about its record in the area of capital punishment. And the United States, which has not ratified the International Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, comes before the Human Rights Council and talks about housing and education and medical care. So it's a very, very fascinating process, and all of the states do it, by the way, and they do it promptly. It's in many ways superior to the very elaborate system we have for the human rights treaties, where many states, including Canada, fairly often are late filing their reports. Some of them don't bother at all. But in the Human Rights Council, they do it. And so the basis of the review by the Human Rights Council is the Charter of the United Nations, which really just mentions human rights and doesn't provide any detail, and the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. So the Universal Declaration of Human Rights has been revived, or not that it was not that it was in danger of dying or withering away, but it's been injected with new energy because of this process, and it's a document that in many ways is more relevant today than ever. So let me talk a little bit about Samuel Moyne and his hypothesis. I think that the reviewer who said that, well, Samuel Moyne has said that the Universal Declaration of Human Rights is not really significant or relevant, probably may have misread the book. I don't think that that's exactly what he says. But there certainly are words that are injected in the description of the adoption of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights that suggests that he doesn't think it was quite as important an event as others might think. And he uses the word, he talks about writers like Marianne Glendon and Elizabeth Borgward and Paul Gordon Lorne as being, what's the word, not euphoric, but celebratory, I think is a term that he uses. And he makes similar references to that. His thesis is that it all began in the 1970s, really. It's interesting. He skips entirely in the 50s and the 60s, which is when we had all the fun. What's Philip Larkin's poem about life began when in between the Chatterley Band and the first Beatles LP. So he misses all of that, and then he moves very quickly to the 1970s. And there his thesis, I think, is that in the 1970s, what had happened was that the older utopias, Marxism, anti-colonialism, third worldism, had all kind of died or had spent their energy. And so he was going to, he says, that's when human rights came into its own. I don't know that he's entirely convinced himself. It's not very convincing finding, because he can't quite explain why it all happens then. He fixes on the magic year is 1977, because that's when Amnesty International wins the Nobel Peace Prize. And that's when, and I think this is probably even more important for him, Jimmy Carter is elected, or takes office as President of the United States. And it's also, of course, the Charter 77 year in Czechoslovakia. So you see all these things come together to make the to make human rights very, very exciting and dynamic. So that, it's kind of, that's when it all begins, rather than in 1948. He probably misses some pieces along the way, and there, I think maybe he gets seduced by the brilliance of his own idea, and so there are some important elements that he doesn't really talk about or address at all. I think in the 1970s, one of the fascinating things about human rights is how the human rights in the United States actually kind of starts to lose momentum. And at the same time, it picks up in Europe and in Canada. I remember as a teenager in Canada, when I first became interested in these issues of fundamental rights, and we used to look with envy at the United States at this fantastic Supreme Court they had that did all these great judgments and could desegregate schools and could change the criminal justice system and could recognize abortion on demand. And by the early 1970s, the United States had stopped capital punishment, actually. They had a judgment of the court, and anyway, they had an effective moratorium long before the Supreme Court suspended, because that's finally all that happened. And somewhere between the suspension of the death penalty by the Supreme Court of the United States and the restoration of it, we're talking 1973 to 1976, I think the United States starts to lose momentum. And oddly, in other countries, Western Europe in particular, and Canada, those movements gain more momentum. So the death penalty is still being applied in Western Europe. France's last execution is 1978. But by the 1980s, Europe and Canada, we have the Charter, we have the Supreme Court, we're starting to, things look fresh and dynamic here, whereas in the United States, there's this loss of the excitement from the to deal with human rights. So I think that's actually the interesting story, and the one that we have to think about and try to explain. And that became so obvious and apparent in the last decade when we looked at the United States under the Bush administration with Guantanamo and torture in Abu Ghraib and so on, and at the same time the condemnation other parts of the world, notably by the European Court of Human Rights when these practices were carried out. So that part is absent from his narrative altogether. Another thing that struck me in reading it, you know, Eleanor Roosevelt famously said that human rights begins in small places, close to home. And when I think of human rights in my life, the small place, so the things that were close to home, the big issues, torture and racial discrimination and so on, they were really far from the reality that I grew up with and knew about. I think that probably the biggest development in human rights that I was close to was the fight for women's equality. Seeing that up close with the women in my family. He doesn't even mention women really in the book, because I couldn't see anything. I don't think it's in the index. It's like that's it was a part of human rights that he just sort of missed entirely. But, you know, I had a grandmother who was, my mother's mother was from Britain. She went to Oxford just over 100 years ago and completed all the credits for a degree, but she couldn't get a degree because women couldn't get degrees at Oxford in those days. And so she learned, not on the internet, but somehow, I don't know how she figured this out, that the University of Alberta would give her a degree for her credits at Oxford if she came and worked for them as a don for a year. So that's what she did, and that's what she met my grandfather, and that's why I'm here in Canada. And my mother went to university, but she did a master's degree, but then she stayed home for a long time raising children because there wasn't really any option in those days. About 20 years ago, I went to a high school reunion, and they saw the girls I'd been in high school back in the 60s. If you had asked us in our high school class what we were going to do when we grew up, the boys were all very ambitious, and they were going to be lawyers and judges and doctors and so on, and surgeons. And the girls were going to be nurses and airline stewardesses and things like that. And my, how it changed in 20 years, where they were all professionals, some academics, university professors, psychiatrists, lawyers and judges and so on. It was the boys who were often a bit disappointed about their careers. I guess they'd been reassured by their dads that they didn't have any competition from the girls, and they learned that actually there was a little more than they expected. And so they tended to be, they had underperformed based on what they thought was going to happen, but the girls had really just overperformed. And I have two daughters who think they can do anything. And maybe it's not quite true, but my, how that part of the world has changed. So that's the part that's close to home for me, and I just noticed that in Samuel Moyn's study, that's just a piece that's entirely absent. So let's go back to 1948 for a few minutes and look at the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and just see how significant it is. Moyn's complaint is that, you know, the declaration, which is adopted on the 10th of December, and that the world doesn't catch fire. You know, it was all supposed to happen very dramatically. A week later, people were going to read the Universal Declaration and the world was going to be transformed. And that doesn't happen. And I don't think anyone would quarrel with the assessment that the 50s and into the 60s were kind of the Dark Ages, for reasons that people in this room could probably explain better than I can. But the Universal Declaration, even assuming it, everything does catch fire in the 1970s. It's like the Universal Declaration are the oil-soaked rags that you put in the corner and then you wait for the spontaneous combustion. And maybe it just takes a little while for that process to happen. Documents have that kind of an existence. They're adopted at a time and they come back again and again because they motivate people and they provide guidance if they're well drafted, which is the case of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Earlier this week, to cite a similar document, but one that's even further back in history, the French Déclaration des droits de l'homme et du citoyen is the basis of a decision at the beginning of this week that I'm sure interests historians by the French Conseil Constitutionnel about the denial of genocide. France has this legislation that makes it a crime to deny genocide or genocides. And this, as I'm sure you can appreciate, could constrain a little bit the métier of the historian, because you have to be checking out everything you're writing if you want to quarrel with the historical truth as proclaimed by a parliamentary resolution about some or another genocide. You risk being prosecuted. And so the French Conseil Constitutionnel cites the articles of the Déclaration des droits de l'homme et du citoyen adopted in 1789, largely drafted by Thomas Jefferson, an American, who goes over to Paris with his friend Lafayette and translates material that comes from the American Revolutionary documents, and that's being cited in Paris this week to knock out that legislation dealing with denial. And the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, of course, will continue to have this life that And it is a brilliant document, I think, because of the way the chemistry of the people who came together when it was being drafted. And they created a document that still speaks to us today. That could be improved, but you wouldn't want to touch it because it might all unravel as well. It might be worse. Let me just point to a few of the examples that show the great clairvoyance of the people who prepared it. I think let's start with Article 1, which is proposed by Annie Cassin, and he borrows it from the French Déclaration des droits de l'homme et du citoyen, which starts with the phrase, tous les hommes naissent libres et égaux. And they're discussing that, and they translate it into English, and I think it's the Indian delegate in the Commission on the Status of Women who says, this bit about all men, I don't think we can live with that. We have problems in India. I don't want to go back to India where they're burning brides and things like this. I'm not going to do that. You've got to change that and make it all men and women. So that's, they do that. They tweak a historic document from 1789, and they create the legal framework, or they reinforce the idea of women's equality, which is, I just said a few words about the significance it had in my life. Article 2, which is the provision dealing with non-discrimination and equality, and yesterday Michael spoke so eloquently about that component of human rights, they inherit for Article 2, the original draft, is based on the Charter of the United Nations, which talks about non-discrimination in Article 1. And there it refers to the fact that people are to be protected from discrimination based on race, sex, language, and religion. And in my research, I found the point where they start to tamper with this language. It's actually not in the Commission on Human Rights, but it's in a subsidiary body, the Subcommission on the Protection of Minorities and the Prevention of Discrimination, which is a body that operated as kind of a think tank for human rights within the UN and was finally abolished in 2006 with the reform of the UN institutions. So they say, well, you know, that's an interesting list, but maybe we should expand the list a little bit. And there's an argument, there's a quarrel, because people say, well, you can't touch the Charter. This is in the Charter of the United Nations, and we don't want to do anything that might undermine the Charter of the United Nations. But they discuss it, and they agree. And so they add some other categories. And they add political opinion, political or other opinion, and social status. And the most important addition is that they put at the beginning of the list, such as. And when you add those words, such as, we have the Charter, the Canadian Charter in Section 15, and that also is borrowed from the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. When you add such as, you enable the document to grow and change over time. It doesn't say anything about sexual orientation. I can assure you, because I've been through all the records, there is not a word about sexual orientation in the debates in 1948. It's not on the radar screen in 1948. But there's room for it because of the words such as. There's nothing about disability. That's not in there. These are our two great equality issues of modern times, disability and sexual orientation. And the Universal Declaration of Human Rights provides room for that in that enumeration in particular because of the words such as. Let me give a third example, Article 3. I'm not going to go through all 30 articles, but I'm just going to say a word about Article 3. But I could go on this way, article by article. Article 3 is the right to life. And when John Humphrey proposes the draft, he's the one who prepares the first draft, John Humphrey draws upon national constitutions, and the national constitutions, which affirm the right to life, they take provisions, they have provisions that talk about the right to life except in the execution of a sentence of death pronounced following a judgment of a court, or similar words. It's in the Fifth Amendment in the U.S. Constitution and in the other constitutions. And Eleanor Roosevelt, the very beginning of the debates in the drafting committee of the Commission on Human Rights in 1947, when they start discussing the substance of the declaration, says, this isn't a good idea to mention the death penalty here. She said, a lot of states are in the course of abolishing the death penalty or stop using it. And it would be a mistake to put that in the declaration, and they agree and they take it out. It was in the Humphrey draft. And it's gone, and it's not in the Universal Declaration, and it enables the Universal Declaration to speak to us today on that subject, the right to life. In 1948, I think probably all but four or five of the 57 members of the United Nations had the death penalty and still used it. And today, this is one of the great stories of human rights over the last 50 or 60 years, is the death penalty has been abolished in the vast majority of states now. Of the UN members, 193 members now, about 150 of them have either abolished it in law or stopped using it for such a length of time that it appears to have been abandoned as a practice. And even in the states that still use it, there are really now only about 30 states that use the death penalty on anything resembling a regular basis. And in most of those states, it's in a sharp decline, including the United States and China and Egypt and Singapore. And there are only a few states where it's actually being maintained or even increasing. And it's a little dark spot on the globe around the Gulf. Saudi Arabia, Iran, Iraq, the nasty countries. That's where it's focused, that's where it's concentrated. But in the rest of the world, it's just dying out faster than it's like watching when there's no snow left, I guess, because they're here. But it is a bit like when the snow starts to melt in the Canadian winter, and then you turn around a day later and it's just all gone. And that's what's happening with the death penalty. And that's, again, thanks to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. So to the extent that Moyne undersells the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, I think he's got it wrong. It really is an extraordinary document, and it's fascinating. I'm fascinated by it, by the contribution and the way that process happens, because it is a lawmaking process. It's not just receiving the wisdom of natural law. I mean, we wouldn't argue if it was so obvious what the natural law is. It's a process of codification and negotiation that goes on. And so I hope you'll find it as fascinating as I am. I did this book because I wanted, it's the first time I've done a book, I wanted it for myself. I didn't really care whether anyone else used it. I want to have it because I want to be able to look up and to go back to 1948 and understand that, what they were thinking and why they did these things, because I think it's such a rich period and it speaks to us with such a salience even today in 2012. There were other things going on in internationally in the field of human rights that I think also make that period extremely rich, and I could speak about a number of them. Let me just mention one or two that I think are of great significance. The Nuremberg trial. The Nuremberg trial was a fascinating development, and the trial itself, of course, is debated by historians. It establishes history in a way, and it provided a model, and I think a very good one. It's a controversial subject, and people always talk about the Nuremberg trial with a certain ambivalence. But I'm a huge fan, personally, of the Nuremberg trial, and the more I look at it, and the more I study it, the more impressed I am with it. It's sometimes criticized for glossing over atrocities and war crimes that were committed by the Allies during the war, and that raises a whole debate about moral equivalence, which is of interest, but I don't have time to go into that. Today there's a chapter on it in the book, if you're interested. They deal with things like the Katyn massacre. The more I looked at that very, very closely, I went through archival material. And it is an area, Nuremberg, that needs more historical research, actually, because there was a great deal going on in the foreign ministries preparing it. It's not just the judgment of the record of the trial, but the instructions they were getting. And there's a great story there about how they dealt, for example, with the Katyn massacre. There was a moment where the British, the Soviets had presented evidence about the Katyn massacre. They had insisted it be in the indictment. It was part of their narrative of the Second World War that the Nazis had committed this atrocity. We know that to have been a lie. Although it was a lie that was probably closely held secret within the leadership. I don't think, from my reading of it, that the actual prosecutors or the judge at the Soviet judges at Nuremberg were in on the lie. That's my reading of it. But there's a British ambassador, I think, in Tehran when the evidence is first produced, and he writes saying that he thinks the Russians did it, actually. And of course, that had been the Nazi position. They had their own commission, and they had put out the story that but the Russians did it. And there was a great resistance to that because people dismissed it as being Nazi propaganda. It was Nazi propaganda, it just happened to be true. And so the British ambassador writes to the Foreign Office, it's in the papers, and says, I think the Russians did it. And there's it's a wonderful little, some one of these bureaucrats in the Foreign Ministry who writes a note, a memo saying, that might be true, but you know, actually, it's politically, it's going to be more useful if we just prove that the Germans did it and convict them of it. You know, what a cynical pastor there in the Foreign Ministry trying to manipulate justice, but the judges don't actually fall for it. And in the final judgment, the judges as a whole ignore the issue. They don't say anything. And the Soviet judge, this is the most interesting, he writes an individual opinion, a separate opinion. He disagrees with the majority on some issues, like how many people should be executed and so on. And this is his chance just to say, well, duty calls, I've got to put the party line in. And he doesn't say a word about it either, I think. He understands as well, he's not convinced one way or the other. If you read the record with it, it's hard to do this, but if you read the trial record where the evidence is produced, and then try to forget everything you know about it and say, does this convince one way or another? It's unconvincing in either direction, finally. But, so my assessment there at Katyn is that Nuremberg actually looks better when you, and yet it's often dismissed when people say, you see, they cynically dealt with Katyn, which was a Soviet crime, and didn't actually address it. And Nuremberg has been a model now for a fabulous system of international justice, the tribunals for Yugoslavia and Rwanda, the International Criminal Court, and a dimension of human rights that didn't exist even in the 70s when Samuel Loyn sees that starting. This is really, this is a much longer period of dormancy, actually, from the late 1940s until the beginning of the 1990s. I could speak about the Genocide Convention and the significance of the Genocide Convention, which was another document drafted at the same time. It's really like the conjoined twin of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. They're actually adopted within 24 hours of each other, and they're negotiated at the same session of the United Nations General Assembly in Paris in 1948. And the Genocide Convention, which again is coming to its own in the 1990s and in the last decade, and we've had more law and more development and more use of it in the last 20 years than in the 40 or so intervening years. So a period of great fertility in terms of human rights law, and I think of great accomplishment. So to the extent that the Last Utopia, Samuel Moyne's book, is kind of dismissive of the 1940s. I think that that's just a mistaken assessment of it. I think he must be a protege. I don't know these people. Maybe some of you in the room know them and go to conferences with them, but they're historians, so they're not on my circuit. But Mark Mazur, who has his latest book, No Enchanted Palace, and it's along the same lines, really. It's saying, don't get too excited about the United Nations. This was actually just a club of old imperialists trying to hang on to power in 1945. And no doubt that was present, but something else is going on. And I think one of the greatest accomplishments of that time, and it's also something that remains a work in progress in human rights, was the way they deal at the time with the use of force and with aggressive war. Because the great accomplishment of the United Nations in 1945, and it's married to the Nuremberg judgment with the condemnation of crimes against peace, and to all of the references in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, including the reference to freedom from fear, which is one of the four freedoms of Franklin D. Roosevelt, is the prohibition on the use of force to settle international disputes, a profound development in international law. And it has given us, I think, over the last 60 years, a relatively peaceful half century. Now that's a very controversial statement, and the people in the human rights field generally we're activists, we're always campaigning, so we're always talking about how things are worse than they were. It's getting worse. More people are being killed, there's more atrocities being perpetrated, and it's worse than it ever was. Which makes me think that, are we contributing to that? Maybe we should just stop doing human rights, because just the harder we work at it, the worse it seems to get. But I don't think that it is getting worse, and that's the other part of it. I think that we're in a period where we can see measurable, important improvement on many of the benchmarks of human rights. I mentioned the death penalty as one example. I mentioned women's equality as another, and I could go on. But I think the biggest story really is the fact that we have largely succeeded in prohibiting the use of force to settle international disputes. Now, the reply to that is, oh yes, but all the killing now is in civil wars. It's in internal conflicts. I think there was lots of killing in internal conflicts 100 years ago too. We just didn't count. It wasn't even measured. But if you look at the last century, it may have been the bloodiest century in human history, but it was the first half of the century that was the bloodiest part of the century, and not the second half. And people have done the numbers, people quarrel about what the numbers are, but when you look at the Second World War, I think if you take the established numbers, you're talking about 25,000 people a day were dying or being killed in the Second World War, and we have nothing comparable to that in modern times, nothing remotely comparable to that. So now that brings me, I should mention that the third book, aside from my own, that I'm going to refer to, which is Stephen Pinker's book about the good angels of nature, and which I think is a very important, the better angels of our nature, I think is a very important addition, a very important contribution. It's full of human rights references, and he does talks about the death penalty. He talks about slavery. He has an interesting discussion there. And he says, you know, don't get carried away with the contemporary forms of slavery. It's true, we have contemporary forms of slavery, but they don't compare with the stuff in the past, with chattel slavery, with ships full of people who are chained to the decks, being transported from one continent to the other to be bought and sold, and that's been largely eliminated. So all of this means to me that it's a history of progress, that human rights, if it's not the only part of that, is a big, big piece of that process. And that it starts not in 1977, but I think it really starts in 1948. Thank you very much.